Well, students, in the previous lecture, we had started with the chapter of lasers, in which we were discussing what happens when light interacts with matter. What happens when incident light falls on a material containing atoms having two energy levels, E1 and E2. And the first process which happens, we had discussed last time, was absorption, in which an atom in the ground state absorbs the energy from the incident photon and goes to the excited state E2. Now, the next process is spontaneous emission. Now, this atom which is in the excited state E2 cannot remain over here for long, because E2 is an excited state. It can remain in this excited state for an average time of about 10 raised to minus 8 seconds, which is a very short time. After that time, the atom from E2 on its own comes down to the ground state spontaneously. It is not being forced to come down, but on its own, it comes down, because E2 is an excited state and the atom cannot remain in E2 for a long time. But when it comes down to the ground state E1, the excess energy which it had, it was in level E2, it has come down to the level E1. So the excess energy E2 minus E1 is emitted in the form of a photon, having energy h nu equal to exactly the energy difference between the two levels, E2 minus E1. So when the atom comes down from the level E2 to the ground state E1, a photon is emitted having energy E2 minus E1. So this process is called as spontaneous emission. The atom spontaneously comes down, on its own it comes down, and it gives out a photon. Now, the spontaneous emission process can be represented by this equation. A star gives A plus H nu. This again can be explained based on the same diagram. What we have before the process, we have an atom in the level excited state E2, so that's A star, excited state atom. What does it give? It gives an atom in the ground state, atom in this level E1, so that's A, plus there's a photon which is emitted, so H nu. So A star gives A plus H nu. Next, how many spontaneous emissions, how many atoms from this material undergo spontaneous emission when light is incident on it? So that's NSP. Number of spontaneous emission taking place in the material. On what factors does it depend upon? Now, for spontaneous emission, atoms have to be initially in the level E1. So more atoms in the level E1 will imply that more spontaneous emissions will take place. So N2. So the number of spontaneous emission taking place in the material is first of all proportional to the number of atoms in the upper level E2. So that's N2. The second factor obviously is time. So the longer the time duration we consider, more atoms from E2 will come down to the level E1. So more spontaneous emissions will take place. So greater the amount of time delta T, number of spontaneous emissions taking place in the material will also be more. So we can say NSP is proportional to N2 and delta T. Or NSP is equal to proportionality constant, which is A21 into N2 delta T. Now, the proportionality constant here is A21. Now, why the letter A? Because spontaneous emission is a spontaneous process. It happens on its own. So, the proportionality constant, the letter is A. And the numbers 2-1. In spontaneous emission, the atom is taken from the level 2 to the level 1. So, 2-2-1. So, that's why it is, the numbers are 2-1. So, this is the number of spontaneous emissions taking place in the material. Now, the important question again, like we had asked in absorption, can spontaneous emission produce light amplification? Now, at first glance, it might seem that yes, it does produce light amplification, because you may say, okay, for example, if there are 50 photons incident on the material, now we'll assume that in this material there are 10 spontaneous emissions taking place. So every spontaneous emission gives rise to one emitted photon. So if there are 10 spontaneous emissions taking place, 10 photons will be emitted. So 50 photons incident plus 10 photons created inside this material because of spontaneous emissions. So total number of emitted photons will be 60. 50 incident plus 10 produced. So total emitted are 60. So incident are 50, but emitted are 60. So you may say that there is light amplification taking place. So it seems to be that. But then there is one slight problem with spontaneous emission. Spontaneous emission is a random process. So what happens is, here is that since spontaneous emission is a random process, the different photons which are emitted spontaneously, they are given out at random times. So they are not all in phase. So let us say this is the first photon which is given out. This is the second photon which is given out. This is the third photon which is given out. Now, if all the photons are emitted at the same time, means they have the same phase, so crest over crest over crest over, all the crests come together. If this is the case, then the resultant of all these photons will give rise to a big photon, large amount of light. Now, this is amplification. Now, this thing does not happen in spontaneous emission. Since spontaneous emission is a random process, the photons are emitted in at different amount, different times. So, it's like this. So, they are emitted with random phases, not all in phase. So, when you add up all these things, so crest coming, trough coming over the crest will cancel out each other. Here also, crest coming over the trough will cancel out each other. So, the resultant of all these things and many photons spontaneously emitted, the resultant is as good as zero. No wave at all, no photon at all. So, in spontaneous emission, since the photons are emitted with random phases, the resultant of all the photons gives almost zero. So, even though photons are emitted, more photons are emitted, since the photons are not in phase, hence spontaneous emission cannot produce light amplification. The last process which takes place when light interacts with matter is stimulated emission of radiation. Now, this is important for us, because only through this process light amplification, that is laser, can occur. So, what is stimulated emission? Now, this is an interesting process. It is an emission. So, emission can take place whether it's spontaneous emission or stimulated emission. Emission can take place only when the atom is initially in the excited state E2. So, here also we start with an atom in the excited state E2. Now, what extra is there over here is that this atom in the excited state E2 is being struck by an incident photon having energy E2 minus E1. So, when this incident photon strikes this atom in the excited state E2, what this photon does is, it forces the atom to come down. It forces the atom to come down exactly at that same instant. Now, please note, if this atom E2 in the excited state is left on its own, it will not remain over there for a long time. It will come down on its own spontaneously. But if before this happens, if before the atom can on its own come down, if it is struck by an incident photon, then this photon can force the atom to come down at that instant of time. So, this is stimulated emission. So, the incident photon is stimulating or forcing the excited state atom to come down to the ground state. And then, what happens in the process? In the process, what happens is, two identical photons are emitted. That is what you see here. Two emitted photons are given out. Now, you may say, where are these two photons coming from? Now, the first photon is the same as the incident photon. Please note, this incident photon is not absorbed by the atom. It is not disappearing. Why? Because the atom initially is already in the excited state. So, there cannot be an absorption taking place. So, this first photon which you see here in the emitted photon is same as the incident photon. The second photon is the photon which arises because of the transition of the atom from the level E2 to E1. So, as the atom comes down, the excess energy which it had E2 minus E1 is given out as the second photon. So, the first photon is the same as the incident photon. And the second photon is the photon arising because of the transition of the atom from E2 to E1. Now, both these photons are exactly identical. So, how many photons were incident on the system? One photon was incident, but how many photons are emitted? There are two photons emitted. So, and which are exactly identical, in the sense that they have the same energy, E2 minus E1. They have the same phase. And also important thing, they have the same direction. Both these photons, emitted photons, have the same direction as the incident photon. So, suppose incident photon was traveling in this direction, let us say from left to right, the two emitted photons which are given out through stimulated emission, they are also in the same direction, that is from left to right, same as the incident photon direction. So, Now, this spontaneous stimulated emission process can be represented by this equation. A star plus h nu gives A plus 2h nu. Now, how do we explain this equation? What is there before? Before, we have an atom in the excited state E2, so that is A star. Plus, there is an incident photon, so which is plus h nu. And what does it give us? The atom has come down to the ground state, so that is A. And two photons, so 2h nu. So, this is the equation representing stimulated emission. How many stimulated emissions will take place in this material? Inside this material, how many stimulated emissions will take place? How many number of atoms will undergo stimulated emission? On what factors will it depend upon? So, NST, number of stimulated emissions, will be proportional to how many atoms are there in the excited state. So, more atoms in the excited state, more stimulated emissions can take place. Because it's an emission. Emission can take place only when atoms are in the excited state. So, more atoms in the excited state, that is N2, more stimulated emissions can take place. Second factor is Q. Now, in this case, Q is a factor. Why? Because if more incident photons are there, more photons are there in the incident radiation, then more stimulated emissions will take place. These incident photons will force more atoms to come down. So, if higher the value of Q, more stimulated emissions can take place. Please note, Q is not a factor in spontaneous emission. There's no Q coming here in spontaneous emission. Why? Because spontaneous emission is a spontaneous process. It doesn't require incident photons. So, therefore, Q doesn't appear in spontaneous emission equation. But Q appears in the expression for stimulated emission. Why? Because for stimulated emission, we require incident photons. So, Q is a factor. And third, obviously, is delta T, the time interval. Longer the time interval we consider, more number of atoms from E2 will be forced to come down to E1. More stimulated emissions will take place. So, number of stimulated emissions is proportional to number of atoms in the upper level, that's N2. Secondly, it's proportional to the incident photon density, that is Q. And third, it is proportional to delta T. So, we can say NST is equal to a proportionality constant, which is B12 into N2 Q delta T. Now, the proportionality constant here is letter is B. Why? Because this is a forced process. This atom is forced to come down by the incident photon to the ground state. It's not coming on its own. It's being forced to come down. So, that's why the proportionality constant is B for forced processes. And 2, 1, the numbers, because the transition is occurring from 2 to 1. Now, so this is the equation which governs the number of stimulated emissions taking place in this material. Now, the question is, important question, can stimulated emission produce light amplification? And the answer is absolutely is yes, it can produce light amplification because, as I told you here, in stimulated emission, the photons are emitted in phase. The photons are emitted in phase. So, this photon and this photon exactly are crest over crest. And all the photons which are emitted, therefore, are exactly in phase. And that gives rise to a large photon, a large amount of light. So, that is light amplification. So, only stimulated emission can produce light amplification as depicted in this diagram. So, how does light amplification take place? So, we start with just one incident photon. This photon goes and collides with an excited atom, that is A star. And what does it do? It forces the atom to come down to the ground state. And in the process, two identical photons traveling in the same direction, forward direction, are emitted. Now, these two photons, as they are traveling through the material, can collide with two more excited atoms A star in their path. So, this photon collides with A star. This also photon collides with another excited atom A star. Both these atoms are forced to come down to the ground state. Each atom, excited state atom, when it comes down to the ground state, through stimulated emission, give rise to two photons. So, two over here and two over here. So, now there are four identical photons. So, we have started with only one and now we have got four. Now, these four traveling in the forward direction may collide with four more excited atoms, force them to come down through stimulated emission and give rise to eight identical photons. So, we started with one and we have got eight within a very short duration of time. So, number of photons keeps on increasing as the photons travel through the material. So, starting with one, within no time, we'll have a very huge number of identical photons, all having the same energy, same phase, and the same direction. This is light amplification. So, that is light amplification taking place through the process of stimulated emission. So, stimulated emission can produce light amplification. So, laser, light amplification through stimulated emission of radiation. Thank you.